gentlemen. For those of you who don't know me, my name is John Minns. I'm the director of the Australian National Centre for Latin American Studies here at the ANU. So welcome to one more of our very many public meetings that we hold here at the ANU. They're all free and open to the public. We have a vast range of meetings like this, but I'm particularly excited tonight to be able to welcome Dr. Daniela di Piramo to do a meeting tonight on the Zapatistas for a number of reasons. One is that I think the Zapatistas are always a topic that inspires support in some cases, in some cases opposition, but are always an interesting topic for people. Particularly for me, because my first trip to Mexico was in 1994. Those of you who know something about the history around that time is on the 1st of January 1994, when the NAFTA treaty came into operation, and also when the Zapatistas came to real public prominence in Mexico and around the world by seizing a number of communities, townships in Chiapas, including San Cristobal de las Casas. And the interesting thing, I think, about the Zapatistas in particular, and I don't think I'm overlapping with anything that Daniela is going to say here, but it seems to me the interesting thing about the Zapatistas at the time is that they were really in one of the most remote states of Mexico and in one of the most remote parts of that remote state in Mexico, and yet they became a major political question throughout the country. I remember in the Zocalo of Mexico City being there, well, a huge demonstration took place in support of the Zapatistas. And then perhaps even more surprisingly, they became really almost a beacon around the world for opposition to what was seen as a predominant mode of running economies and methods of development, a neoliberal model of development that by 1994 had really become predominant. So they really attracted attention around the world far beyond their numbers, far beyond probably the likelihood of their influence and their ability to achieve their own aims. So I think the Zapatistas are well worth discussion and plenty of attention. And Dr. Daniela di Piramo is very well qualified to provide exactly that attention. She is a researcher at Griffith University in Queensland, and she has a special interest in the Zapatistas, and in particular, of course, the emblematic leader of the Zapatistas, Subcomandante Marcos. Her last book was published less than two years ago, was entitled Political Leadership in Zapatista Mexico, Marcos, Celebrity and Charismatic Authority. And she's currently working on a variety of papers on Hugo Chávez and ideas of populism and political leadership in Latin America. So Daniela will speak for about 40 minutes. And then there's plenty of time for questions and discussion in the formal sort of section of the meeting here in the room. I, of course, will do my usual advertisements for upcoming events after that. And then there's plenty of time as well over refreshments in the foyer to continue the discussion much less formally. So please welcome Dr. Daniela di Piramo.
Thank you, John. All right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to thank ANU, ANCLAS, and in particular Dr. John Minns, who invited me here tonight. I would also like to thank Mr. Guy Emerson for designing a wonderful poster, and Ms. Claudia Villegas for facilitating my travel to Canberra. And I would like to thank you, the audience, for being here tonight. Your presence here sends a message to me that public interest in politics has not died altogether, and that perhaps we are all in this room because something about the Zapatista movement is truly inspiring. And you will see, I'll have a few slides with a bit of writing on them, because I'm not sure how much you guys know, so I thought it was safer to give you some of the basic facts and a couple of maps to get, you know, a bit of orientation. And then I have a series of photos that are actually being donated, they've been donated to me while I was in Mexico by a Mexican academic, a couple of them also from another person, one of my colleagues at Griffith University. And so I'd like you to enjoy this and imagine that you are in Mexico if possible. That's the idea of having the photos, and they're nowhere else to be found, so, hopefully not find anything on the internet, I know. But I'll start now, and I'm going to take the easy way out and read, because otherwise I tend to get off off track, so I will read, but I also will ad lib here and there. Okay, so first of all, we have the contents. And I said that the Zapatista movement is truly inspiring, and this is precisely what I will speak about tonight. Why it was the Zapatista movement that captured the attention of thousands, and not any of the hundreds of movements that populate the Latin American continent. I'm going to divide this lecture in four parts. First, I will go back to the beginning of the Zapatista movement, tell you a little bit about how it emerged. Second, I will briefly discuss the reaction to the Zapatistas. Third, I will discuss some of the elements of the Zapatista movement and that explain, in my view, why it emerged so vividly in the popular imaginary. And I put forward four reasons. One, the message or the ideas. Two, symbolism. Three, the use of the new media. Four, leadership. These elements may not individually have made a significant impact. However, I believe that when in conjunction, all together with one another, or in conjunction with one another, they're quite powerful. Finally, I will conclude by offering an assessment of what the Zapatistas tried to achieve and whether they succeeded in their endeavor. I would like to stress that these conclusions are based on my research and my interpretation of the information. I did my PhD on this movement, and my book that John mentioned before. Nevertheless, I do not claim that my views are the only explanation or the most complete one either. I would also like to stress that as a Western scholar, I do not claim to be speaking for the indigenous peoples of Chiapas. Part one, how the movement emerged. The origins of the Zapatista movement are simply fascinating. You may have heard that the January 1994 armed uprising in Mexico, Chiapas, was caused by the opposition to the NAFTA agreement, which made the Mexican government sign with the US and Canada. However, while this might be considered an immediate cause, it does not explain the emergence of the movement adequately. In fact, several long-term and short-term factors contributed to the formation and the development of the Zapatista movement. Before we go any further, just have a look at the map. Chiapas is right down the bottom right, that is, of Mexico. And the next map might be a little bit hard to see, but I will be telling you a little bit about it. The state is divided in a number of regions, the highlands in the center, the canyons in the east, the central valley in the southwest, and the La Condona jungle or the rainforest in the northeast, which is recognized as one of the world's most biodiverse areas. In Chiapas, we find one of the highest proportions of indigenous inhabitants in Mexico. The collective raw ethnic group is that of the Maya people, and within this group there are several groups, subgroups, including the Tzotzil, Tetzel, Tojolabal, and Chol. Chiapas is also one of the richest regions in Mexico in terms of resources. At the time of the rebellion, it possessed one of the world's largest untapped oil fields, and it produced nearly 50% of Mexico's natural gas and 60% of its hydroelectric power, as well as much of its coffee and oil, as well as lumber, corn, beef, bananas, honey, melons, avocados, and cocoa. Paradoxically, Chiapas is one of the poorest states in Mexico, or at least it was at the time of the rebellion. Many indigenous homes did not have electricity. Only 10% had running water, and only half had access to clean drinking water. Over 70% of the population live below the poverty line. And the state had the highest illiteracy rate in Mexico, which was 56%. In Chiapas, there was also the lowest life expectancy and the highest infant mortality rate in the country. Unfortunately, I witnessed that myself when I was there. It is important to note that modern Mexican politics have largely been shaped by the Mexican Revolution that began in 1910 as a challenge to the rule of dictator Porfirio Diaz. Land has always been an issue in Mexico. At the time of the revolution, 97% of the land was owned by 1% of the population. After the overthrow of the Diaz regime, Mexico went through more than a decade of insurrection, civil wars, fragmentation of the political system, with national heroes Francisco Pancho Villa leading the fight in the northern states, and of course Emiliano Zapata in the south. The PRI is the Institutional Revolutionary Party. It was then called the National Revolutionary Party. It took over in 1929. It regarded itself as the legitimate heir of the revolution. This ideologically ambiguous and corporatist party dominated politics in Mexico until 2000, when PAN, the National Action Party, which is a conservative party, won the elections. It is important to realize that traditionally Chiapas has been run by a network of caciques. Caciques are local political bosses who were often landowners as well as the principal local representatives of the PRI. They were supported by local elites of politicians and businessmen who enriched themselves at the expense of the rest of the population. Repression was perpetrated on behalf of these powerful social actors by pistoleros. They had hired gunmen and guardias blancas, white guards, that is the paramilitary groups that were originally formed in the 1920s, and I'll be saying more about them a little bit later. Time for the photo show, okay. We can divide the factors that contributed to the emergence and relative success of the movement in two kinds, economic and political. The first economic factor that contributed to the emergence is a struggle of land, for land. One view is that the revolution's land reform failed to reach Chiapas. This problem was compounded by the impact of global capitalism on the Mexican economy and Chiapas in particular. The oil crisis of the 1970s was followed by an economic crisis in the early 1980s. Policies addressing the debt crisis were imposed and implemented in Mexico, as in many other places. They included cuts in social expenditure and also infrastructure, as well as the privatization of national assets and public companies. The PRI, headed by Carlos Salinas, amended the famous post-revolution Article 27 of the Mexican Constitution, so that land that was previously held in common, ejidos, that is, excuse my pronunciation, could now be bought and sold. In Chiapas, products like coffee and maize had to compete in the deregulated global markets. That means the prices dropped and government subsidies were often terminated. These are the economic factors which were complemented by social factors in Chiapas, as probably in other parts of Mexico, history of racism and discrimination against indigenous population. In the meanwhile, the PRI and its traditional structures of patronage were having difficulties dealing with these new economic conditions. So, amidst allegations of corruption, internal conflict, and two assassinations, the party began to lose credibility in the 70s, or if you had to pinpoint the time. Moreover, a variety of political and ideological factors coalesced to form the intellectual and organizational foundations of the movement. To explain this, we need to go back to the student movement of the late 1950s in Mexico City. In 1968, there was a massacre at Loloco Square when the army opened fire on 30,000 UNAM students. UNAM is a huge national university of Mexico, Universidad Nacional Autónoma de Mexico. They were demanding an end to human rights abuses and corruption, as well as the recognition of civil rights. This movement was the foundation of a brand of political activism that was to survive as a number of splinter groups sought refuge in the provinces. Intertwined with these factors, we have the history of peasant struggle, influenced by the ideas of Emiliano Zapata, who formed the first agrarian organizations. And they, some of them, a couple of them in particular, virtually grew within the Zapatista movement, or grew into the Zapatista movement. Another political factor was liberation theology, which essentially is a challenge to the limitations of the church, with respect to the struggle for social justice. The central figure in Chiapas was Samuel Ruiz Garcia, or the Red Bishop, as they called him, who mobilized the people to challenge the system of domination. He was crucial to the development of the movement. Adding to these factors were a number of indigenous organizations who demanded better conditions, better medical services, and preservation of Indian cultures, and so on. These demands were reflected in the declarations of the Lacandona, and there are six of them, and the first declaration, in particular, makes very clear these demands very, very clearly. Last, we have the guerrilla movements that sprang up everywhere all over Mexico in the 1960s, as well as the wider Latin American context with the Shining Path in Peru, the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, the FMLN in Salvador, and of course the Cuban Revolution. It is widely believed that the EZLN, which is the Zapatista Army of National Liberation, originated from the FLN, which was a Marxist organization, Marxist-Leninist group, in conjunction with two Maoist other smaller organizations. Now, this FLN was founded in Monterrey in 1969 in response to the student movements that I mentioned before. A group of activists established a cell in Chiapas in the early 70s. It was called Guerrillero Emiliano Zapata. In 1974, the Mexican army dealt a severe blow. It destroyed a lot of the centers of operation, including the cell that was in the Chiapan jungle, and assassinated the leader, Cesar Yanez. However, some cells survived, particularly in Monterrey and Torreon, where they came into contact with liberation theology I mentioned before. And by the late 1970s, the movement had been resurrected, or in various parts of Mexico. This Cesar Yanez, he had a brother called German. German is one of the founders of the EZLN. It seems that 12 activists from the FLN returned in Chiapas. He was one of them, German. The number went down to three. You have German, Rodolfo, and Elisa, and formed the EZLN one day, which we believe to be November 17, 1983, with three other indigenous members. And in May 1984, we believe Marcos joined them. Now, there are different versions of this story, depending on whose book you read, of course. But this is the one that was, to me, it sounded, from my research, I thought I would go along with. Who forms the base of the movement? Well, the Zapatistas, very briefly, were the people who migrated to the Lacandona jungle and the canyons in order to resolve the problem of being landless, basically, in the highlands, which were dominated by mestizos, run by caciques, and had a lot of internal disputes. So this, in a way, they were pioneers, they were hoping to get a better life when they migrated, but it was the cattle ranchers that seized a lot of the lands in the places where they migrated, so it was still a struggle. The new settlers were left out of government welfare programs and lived in extreme poverty. Social isolation, economic hardship, and political exclusion are factors that explain the development of the Zapatista movement in those locations. So essentially, the process of separation from the communities of origin and the migration itself implied the reconstruction of a new world of multi-ethnic and multilingual communities, which is reflected in the composition of the movement and the EZLN. The communities initially turned to the Zapatista army for protection. The elements of liberation revolution became predominant later. Indeed, the EZLN is hierarchical, or was more in the beginning, a hierarchical centralized command structure modeled on the Mexican army, and according to some scholars, it continues to be an authoritarian organization. Marcos himself admits that the Zapatista army was not born democratic, but that a, quote, form and organization of the indigenous communities permeated and dominated our movement, and we had to democratize the Indian way. There is a direct link between the Zapatistas' rejection of hierarchical and authoritarian modes of organization and some of the practices of the student movement that I mentioned before, and also, of course, indigenous and the peasant organizations. So we have decentralization and non-hierarchical structures. However, there is a command structure in the movement, which is there is a central decision-making committee. It's called the CCRICG, which is the General Command of the Clandestine Revolutionary Indigenous Committee. That was formally constituted in 1993. It has 12 delegates. It has jurisdiction over the EZLN. Below this, you have the revolutionary committees, which were created at the same time, with 16 to 40 delegates that come from the communal assemblies. At the local level, as noted above, the Zapatistas put forward a series of demands to address the predicament of the indigenous people of Chiapas, including food, land, housing, jobs, health, and so on. At the national level, the movement continued its critique of the state by demanding a more participatory form of democracy. They wanted to, at the beginning, the first declaration, appeal to the sovereignty of the people very explicitly, and it demanded the dismantlement of President Salinas' government and the fundamental reform of the electoral and constitutional system to make the government more accountable and more fair. Soon after 1994, the movement expanded to a global level. So you have the three levels there, local, national, and global, challenging a neoliberal project as part of the anti-globalization solidarity network. We would not be here tonight. I'm doing the response to the Zapatista movement now. We would not be here tonight if the movement had not reached a remarkable level of visibility. Almost overnight, after the 1994 uprising, the EZLN and its subcomandante became household names, and in and beyond Mexico, while hundreds of communiques, their messages, were posted on the internet and sent to the press, signed by either the EZLN or Marcos, and published in Mexico largely by La Jornada. Within Chiapas, the EZLN was supported by a large number of indigenous communities, but not all indigenous people in Chiapas support the Zapatistas. I think this is something that is a misunderstanding that people have when they don't know they haven't been there. The also radical sector of the church supported the movement, and a number of left-wing radicals, of course. In the rest of Mexico, the political vision and the message of the Zapatistas resonated with sections of the working and the middle class, portions of the Mexican intelligentsia, not all of them, the organized left, students, indigenous groups, and some human and civil rights movements. According to Montfort Guillén, the most significant support for the Zapatistas came from the Mexican middle class rather than the marginalized classes. This support was a result of frustration, anger, and dissatisfaction, and disillusionment with the political system and the empty promises of modernity, rather than an intellectual flirtation or love of violence or guilt. Although I think guilt might have something to do with it as well. The international media, both mainstream and alternate, fell in love with the Zapatistas. But it was Marcos who attracted most of the attention, as the foreign public became fascinated by an indigenous rebellion led by a mestizo, who is a person of mixed heritage. Numerous interviews were granted to famous journalists from New York Times and all these type of publications. Plus, of course, you have people like Bellinghausen, who was very active, pursued a lot of interviews. At various encuentros and meetings and conventions that were organized right through, that still are being organized now, but right through the 90s, they were very new then, new idea. People like Danielle Mitrend arrived in Chiapas, also Oliver Stone and other celebrities. Plus, Marcos has been engaging in communication with people like Regis Debray and Octavio Paz, Carlos Fuente, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, and also, of course, letters have been flowing from Rigoberta Menchú, Umberto Eco, and Noam Chomsky, and all these type of intellectuals and activists. It did seem as though all the cliches and ideas about Latin-style political soap operas that appeal to Europeans and Northern Americans had just become reality. Perverse governors, revolutionary bishops, heroic guerrillas, and defenseless Indians all came to life in a spectacle whose willing audience was perhaps either a bored or a guilty society. The academic world went into absolute overdrive about the Zapatistas. The Zapatistas feature or are referred to in thousands of articles, books, and websites. Many academics seem hell-bent on romanticizing the movement, and Marcos in particular. The interest of European intellectuals in Marcos has been the subject of a lot of criticism. Indeed, at times one has to question the professionalism and objectivity of the Western scholarship. My personal observations when I was in Mexico led me to conclude that it's much more outside of Mexico that the Zapatistas are placed on a pedestal. In Mexico, the scholarship seemed to be quite divided to me, in particular about Marcos, who is considered by some as a caudillo in postmodern clothes. For local critics, the situation is symptomatic of the lack of critical distance and the complacency that has contributed to the formation of a set of actors and conditions in Mexico that animate what some people call intellectual lightness. Or perhaps you could look at a whole situation as a result of inadequacies of the left, both nationally and globally, notwithstanding the pink tide in the region. There are no prizes for guessing that if the intelligentsia needed intrigue, a portion of the left needed an alternative to the alleged failure of Marxism, no matter how utopian the fix might be. There is also the idea of a contemporary and not just Mexican quest for enchantment. Nevertheless, we should not be too cynical. After all, the Zapatistas struck a chord with those who have or wish to acquire credentials in humanitarianism, and with thousands of people who are not sure of where they fit in the world, and they find the fluidity of the movement very, very appealing. Also, a distinction needs to be made between the response of the people to the movement and the response of the people to Marcos. And any assessment one might make should not assume that the two can be easily separated, because it's actually very hard to separate them. Outstanding elements. Very quickly, I'm going to go through the four elements that I explained at the beginning. What elements made the Zapatistas stand out from the rest? Now, remember that the moods that I've just described are important in relation to these elements. The first is the ideas, the message, the quest for a more radical understanding of citizenship and democracy as a collective, more inclusive experience, not representative, but a more direct participatory form of democracy. Similarly, the nation state is understood or redefined as a fragmented multi-ethnic entity rather than a universal centralized one. There is really nothing new about much of the terminology that Zapatistas employ because, you know, freedom, equality, rights, some of those go back to the French Revolution. But I think that there are some other elements that are more novel. One would have to be the emphasis on horizontal organization consultation, which I mentioned before. The other one is the refusal to join the official political system, i.e. become a party and participate or run for elections. Some people think that they are an anarchist movement. And particularly controversial was their refusal to support the PRD in the 2006 elections. I acknowledge the emphasis on autonomy and decentralization, which is expressed in the creation of these autonomous communities. However, I'm very reluctant, and I really don't identify the movement as a purely anarchist movement. It has anarchist elements, I think, which is quite different. To me, the autonomous communities are a reaction against the Mexican state, not the idea of state. They want to redefine the nation state, but they don't want to do away with it altogether. Actually, nowhere they say that. The other interesting and related factor is the refusal to impose or specify a political program, and Marcos talks about creating political space for the people to decide what they want. So he actually talks about civil society needing to wake up. He actually said that. And also, I'm going to have to run through this quickly. The initial use of arms was justified by a lack of faith in the existing political system, which is a classical revolutionary argument. However, they changed to peaceful, you know, they changed that tactic very early. And that, I think, put them in good relationship with the Mexican civil society. I think that was good in that sense. Although I don't think Marcos discounts the use of arms altogether. I don't think he does. But anyway, at the end of it, what they gained from that is that they were able to maintain the morally higher ground in their conflict with the government. Unfortunately, repression against Zapatistas has continued I believe it's continuing today. We have new, of course, there was the Ectil massacre of 1990, in the 1990s, which was extremely disturbing and upsetting. There are new paramilitary groups now. One of them is a splinter group from Paz and Justicia, which ironically means peace and justice. That was one of the main paramilitary groups. The exclusion and marginalization that have led to the search for self-determination and the preservation of Indian identities are linked to the struggle against globalization and, of course, neoliberalism. They have become symbols of resistance to the universalizing project of global capitalism. Still, I don't think it's so much a message, but the way it's delivered that is novel and new about the Zapatistas. Other than the communiques and the manifestos, which are essentially the declarations of the Lacandona I mentioned earlier, Marcos has written political essays, some of them are straightforward political essays, but also he has also written a lot of dialogues and some tales, Mayan-inspired tales, tales that take inspiration from the Mayan culture, and they're using very clever allegories to present serious political issues in a way that it's imaginative and much easier to understand and very colorful. In particular, the less conventional pieces portray the anti-ideological or the postmodern inclinations of the Zapatista movement. But I argue in one of my articles that they don't escape modernism completely. That, you know, I mean, they always, you know, it always there's always that pullback, you know, that return to the idea of the boundaries of modernity, so to speak. Several details feature old Antonio, who is actually, Marcos argues that, this person did exist. He was a Tetzel Maya shaman who functioned as a bridge between the Zapatistas and the communities. And Marcos considered him his mentor and teacher and the intellectual author of the Core Ideas of Zapatismo. Then there is the beetle. A beetle Marcos engages in conversations with. He is a beetle who wears glasses and smokes a pipe. So and they discuss the irrationality of neoliberalism and the state of the world. The use of symbolism is very evident. That's the second element ahead. It's drawn from the natural elements. There are the tales, of course, use symbolism, but also dawn is the image of hope because that's where the day starts. Clouds are without a face, like the Isatelen. The caracoles are the sites of resistance. They were established in 2003 to replace the agua calientes. Now, the caracoles has got a lot of meaning in Mayan culture. It's very complex. But in what we understand, you know, normally by the snail is that it's a slow animal. So it's a slow movement to change, a slow path to political change. Steady, slow but steady. And agua calientes means hot waters. And it's in memory of a constitutional convention held in a town of that name in 1914. Another symbolic strategy is to promote political events on meaningful dates like Zapata's anniversary of death and the massacre of the students that I mentioned before. They always do something on those days, to remember. The Zapatista movement and Marcos have relied heavily on visual symbols, which are very effective politically. The Paz de Montaña and the ski mask. There are Zapatista murals on the walls of public buildings that tell their own stories. Marcos appears on a horse wearing the cartridges crossed on his chest, conjuring up Zapata's image, and at the same time obscuring his own personal identity. We'll go back there shortly. The horse is important in Mexican folklore. Also, there's a lot of symbolism from the Cuban Revolution. Some people here wearing the star tonight. Che Guevara and choice of colors, red and black, National Liberation Army, this sort of name, the symbol of the star, although Marcos explains that differently. The third element is the use of the media, in particular the new media. The Zapatistas may have lost the military war but won the media battle. Words are a weapon, as Marcos says, and information is a commodity in this world. It is true, that is quite a true fact. Through new technologies, the Zapatistas were successful in conveying the message to the rest of the world that Chiapas was a casualty of neoliberalism as much as of its own national history. They were able to exchange information, opinions, ideas, organize global encounters, and join solidarity networks. They were able to maintain an informal rapport with support groups and NGOs. In this way, the movement managed to gain unprecedented transnational presence. They reach millions of people in their own homes this way, and people will sit at the computer and feel like they're actually participating in the movement, I guess. This is what the virtual revolutionary. Ronfield, Arquilla, and Fuller, who are conservative think tank in America, argue that it was transnational NGO activism attuned to the information age and not the Israelis themselves that made insurgency novel. In my opinion, there is no doubt that the NGO activism did alter the dynamics of the confrontation in Chiapas by drawing international actors sympathetic to the conflict, to the Zapatistas into the conflict, which in turn put pressure on the Mexican authorities to deal with the rebels in a less aggressive manner and created a sense of justified global resistance to the evils of neoliberalism. One could argue that it is the Zapatista movement that has promoted transnational activism, or at least made it fashionable, rather than the other way around. Finally, we come to the fourth element, Subcomandante Marcos. There is no doubt he is one of the main reasons for the visibility of the movement, just as there is no doubt that he is a controversial and enigmatic political figure who has sparked debate on a number of points. The purpose of the mask, the puzzle of whether he is a leader, the leader, or the non-leader of the Zapatista movement. Questions have been asked as to whether he's marginal or central to the movement and what is his role. He's been given many labels: mass guerrilla, philosopher, revolutionary, poet, shaman, intellectual, erotic symbol, and professional of hope. Although he dresses like a traditional revolutionary, he has a very different style to Fidel Castro, completely different, even Che Guevara, quite different, and the mystical romanticism of the situation did not escape notice. He is the must non-indigenous spokesperson or leader of an indigenous movement. He is the face of the movement to the West. According to Guillermo Prieto, he is elusive and intimate at once, a combination of attributes that proved irresistible to the media and audiences, which is the essence of celebrity, in my view, which is the intimacy and the elusiveness combined. Almost overnight after the 1994 uprising, he became a household name, and of course, with all the merchandise and being reproduced, he's been reproduced in calendars, T-shirts, pens, and Marcos dolls and keyrings and so on. So he's, in a way, he was a marketer's dream, I suppose. But while a hero to many, to others, he's a typical Latin American caudillo, solely motivated by personal political ambition. The masterful sedata of a legion of national and international scholars, activists, and observers, to whom he feeds eloquent writings, a carefully crafted image, and political theatrics. Never having attempted to seize power, his revolutionary credentials are in serious doubt. In real life, according to the Mexican government, Marcos is 50-something, middle class, Rafael Sebastian Guillen, a former Marxist activist and UNAM academic. At some stage in the early 80s, Rafael Sebastian Guillen disappeared, possibly in the Lacandona jungle. Marcos continuously teases the media. He tells various interviewers in his soft manner that he's not the leader or even one of the leaders of the movement. He is accountable to the committee I mentioned before. However, his role is ambiguous. This ambiguity is a subject of my book, where I argue that his meteoric rise to celebrity status befitting a postmodern revolutionary icon is at odds with his anti-authoritarian and anti-personalistic political discourse. It also seems to me to be at odds with the sort of progressive politics that Zapatista movement has been busy promoting, an empowered civil society and a non-hierarchical concept of power. My position is that Marcos is more than a spokesperson, which I think is quite an inadequate media term. He's a leader of sorts. He's charismatic, but while we should not dismiss the personalistic element, it would be grossly inaccurate, in my opinion, to position him as a typical Latin American charismatic leader. In other words, he continuously strives to limit his personal presence in the movement, thus avoiding or minimizing cult status, caudillismo, and vanguardismo. He adopts a strategy of disengage engagement, in which he consciously distances himself from his own political persona, even while he's employing it for the good of the movement. This is why he called himself Delegado Zero in the other campaign, and this is also behind the cry, "We're all Marcos." The mask is the way in which he attempts to be a non-person, or the faceless leader, so that people can focus and listen to the message and not feed into the obsession with the person who is speaking. And personally, he wants people to identify themselves with the message in a personal way. Not with him, but with themselves. The subcomandante often talks about how he does not succeed entirely in depersonifying himself. His role in the relative success of the Zapatista movement was crucial, as I said before. He managed to obtain support for the movement, otherwise it might have been wiped out, as the FLN was many years before. He was able to ensure the movement had the moral upper hand and legitimacy in the eyes of the nation by framing it in the context of national revolutionary history. He successfully established a dialogue with a significant number of intellectuals in Mexico and beyond, and also with international organizations. Of course, none of this is as straightforward as it sounds. He had many, intellectual discussions with people, not to say that these dialogues were all peaceful. Even with the church, I believe that there was some friction between the Isatalan and the church as well. So nothing is as simple as it seems. I would like to conclude by restating the uniqueness and importance of the Zapatistas. Clearly, there are serious political consequences to their unwillingness to join the political system, the vagueness of their political program, the near invisibility of the Mayan leadership, and the alleged negative repercussions in Chiapas. There has been a great deal of cynicism with regard to the political effectiveness of a seemingly solutionless movement. Many observers judging the Zapatista movement to be political pie in the sky. The San Andreas Accords on Indigenous Rights and Culture were signed in February 1996, but were never implemented by the government in their original version. There were many who commented on the failure of the other campaign tour in 2006, and even blamed the Zapatistas for the PRD losing that election. Left-wing movements nowadays have adopted a much more pragmatic approach to politics, perhaps sacrificing the more idealistic version of the bigger picture in order to survive, because they have to survive in the political system. To the moderate left, any gain is better than not being in the game at all. But from where the Zapatistas stand, this kind of compromise is self-defeating. Nothing really changes in terms of power relations if one person or one party merely replaces another on the same basis. Of course, it is necessary to be cautious about claims that deny the necessity or even the disability of institutional political power. Political success should not be measured, however, by election results or cut and dry solutions. The Zapatistas were successful at placing issues of land, economic redistribution, and indigenous autonomy on the political agenda. They encouraged gender equality in the communities. At all levels, global, national, and local, they challenge neoliberal capitalism and representative democracy. There has been a degree of creativity, I think, in the plebiscites, conventions, consultas, encounters, and all type of interaction with civil society, which has contributed to the construction of national and global spaces of coordination, discussion, and organizations. Many encounters, festivals, and tributes have continued right through, many commemorating the dead. Comandante Ramona, Bishop Samuel Ruiz Garcia, and anthropologist Andres Aubrey, to mention a few. The Zapatistas have stimulated significant debate amongst academics on many issues. They disprove Castaneda's assertion that the Latin American revolutionary left is dead, although the idea of a revolution might be of a different kind. Finally, and most importantly, they have inspired countless groups, organizations, and individuals. The humanism of their political message reverberates within and beyond Mexican borders. It was heard at the second international seminar of reflection and analysis that took place in San Cristobal in December last year, the end of December to January early this year, to commemorate the 18th anniversary of the Zapatista movement. It was heard when the Chilean student movement credited the Zapatistas for inspiration in the creation of more equitable modes of organization. A similar comment was made by the Union of Border of Agricultural Workers in El Paso, Texas. The list goes on, and it includes a movement for justice in El Barrio and Occupy Wall Street. Movingly, it was heard in the words of Javier Sicilia, the poet and father of Juan Francisco Sicilia, who was gunned down with six other people in the so-called war against drugs waged by the Mexican government last March. Javier Sicilia launched the March for Peace, with Justice and Dignity in May 2011. Thousands of Zapatistas and the EZLN responded by marching in San Cristobal. This is what Javier Sicilia had to say. The last 18 years have been fundamental since the Zapatistas, by revealing the negation of the indigenous world that had been going on for centuries, also revealed the dysfunction of the state and the neoliberal system, and gave new content and new possibilities, not only to the nation, but to the entire world. The Zapatistas have not left. They're continuously being reinvented in new forms of resistance against a common enemy. Thank you.
I think you can guarantee one thing about the Zapatistas is that there's virtually no political forum where you don't get very strong opinions expressed about them, even on the left, let alone between left and right politics.
Yes.
So it always leads to an interesting discussion. But I'd like you to thank Daniela di Piramo for
coming. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.